For I wouldn't, brethren, that ye should be ignorant of this mystery, lest ye should be wise in your own conceits, that blindness in part is happened to Israel, until the fullness of the Gentiles be come in. And so all Israel shall be saved. As it's written, there shall come out of Zion the Deliverer, and shall turn away ungodliness from Jacob. For this is my covenant unto them, when I shall take away their sins. Verse 25 gives one of seven mysteries given in the New Testament. If a man is ignorant of this mystery, then he is wise in his own conceits. So if a man thinks that God is all true with Israel, then he is ignorant and conceited. Now here are the facts concerning God's dealing with Israel in this passage. Israel is blind spiritually as a nation, but only partly. There are still Jews receiving Jesus Christ, the light of the world, as their Savior. Second, the fullness of the Gentiles is about to come to an end. The rapture will fulfill the body of Christ, and then Jews and Gentiles will be saved separately. Third, at the end of the tribulation, when Jesus Christ returns, all the surviving Jews will look on the glorified body of their Messiah and accept Christ as their Lord and Savior, verse 26. Fourth, God will then establish a new covenant with the nation of Israel. Verse 27, compare Hebrews chapter 8, verses 8 to 12. Israel will one day regain its ascendancy over the nations, but not before her Messiah returns and gets rid of her sin of unbelief. Now these three verses are connected to two great Bible doctrines, the restoration of Israel and the premillennial return of Jesus Christ. Some of the Old Testament passages that are connected with these doctrines are Isaiah chapter 2 and 11 and Ezekiel chapter 36 and 40-48, Zephaniah chapter 3, Micah chapter 7 and Zechariah chapters 12-14. The king doesn't reign merely in heaven or in the hearts of Christians, amillennialism. He doesn't return through the church or after the church rules 1,000 years, postmillennialism. The king returns with his church, Revelation chapter 19. He returns to his people, Israel, Matthew chapter 24. He then reigns 1,000 years, 1,000 annum years, Revelation chapter 20. Any man who doesn't believe those things is stupid and proud. That includes, for example, John Calvin. He didn't believe it. Verse 26, and so all Israel shall be saved. Some Christians teaches that no Christian needs to confess his sins after he is saved to stay in fellowship with God, 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. And some also twist Romans chapter 11, verse 26, to say that all Israel means every Jew who has ever lived will one day be saved, so there is no need to witness to them. Based upon what Paul has already said in Romans chapter 9 and 10, that is completely absurd. Why would Paul have such a burden over something that was going to happen anyway? Romans chapter 10, verse 1. Why would he wish himself accursed? Romans chapter 9, verse 3. If every single Jew who ever lived would automatically be saved at the second advent, why go to hell and burn forever for somebody who wasn't going there himself? Now let's get something straight. First, Dathan and Abiram went down alive into the pit, Numbers chapter 16, verse 33. They didn't go to purgatory or to limbo. Second, Jesus said of the rich man in Luke chapter 16 that in hell he lifted up his eyes. Got that? That rich man was a Jew, Luke chapter 16, verse 24, Father Abraham. He went to hell, torments, flame, evil things, that hell. Third, the scribes and Pharisees, whom Christ addressed in Matthew chapter 23, weren't children of God or children of Abraham, John chapter 8, verse 39. They were children of hell, Matthew chapter 23, verse 15. Fourth, Jesus Christ himself said to the Jew, ye must be born again, John chapter 3, verse 7. Fifth, John the Baptist said to Pharisees and Sadducees who came to hear him, O generation of vipers, who hath warned you to flee from the wrath to come? He shall baptize you with fire. He will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. Matthew chapter 3, verses 7 to 12. Those are the clear verses. Those are the straight verses. All in Romans chapter 11, verse 26 has nothing to do with all Jews throughout time. Now it's pretty much clear that Jews are hard to witness to. They are still a stiff-necked people, Acts chapter 7, verse 51. But the Lord hasn't given up on them, and neither should you. But if you do, whatever you do, don't try to justify your dirty, rotten sin with the scriptures. Just admit that you are too lazy, or too cowardly, or too hard-hearted to witness to them. But don't blame God for your wrongdoing. And so, the "so" refers to the times of the Gentiles being fulfilled. When that happens, then all Israel shall be saved. The Lord says in Zechariah chapter 12, verse 10, I will pour upon the house of David, upon the inhabitants of Jerusalem, meaning those living at the time this happens, the spirit of grace and of supplications, and they shall look upon me, Jehovah, verse 1, whom they have pierced, Jesus Christ, Revelation chapter 1, verse 7, and they shall mourn for him, as one mourneth for his only son, who is doing the mourning, Zechariah chapter 12, verse 14, all the families that remain. There was the all of Romans chapter 11, verse 26. The rest of verse 26 is a quote from Isaiah chapter 59, verse 20. The salvation of Israel as a nation occurs when her deliverer shows up. Note in Isaiah chapter 59, verse 20, he is called the Redeemer. The idea is that right now Israel is under the thumb of her enemies, the Gentiles, just as she was under the power of Pharaoh in Exodus. In Exodus, the Lord purchased his people, Exodus chapter 15, verse 16. That purchase was made with the blood of the Passover lamb, when the Lord slew the firstborn of Egypt, Exodus chapter 13, verses 13 to 15. That purchase was followed by a military deliverance from the Egyptians, Exodus chapter 15, verses 1 to 3. So when Christ met the two men on the road to Emmaus, they told him, "But we trusted that it had been he which should have redeemed Israel." Luke chapter 24, verse 21. Isn't that what Christ did? Didn't he die and shed his blood to redeem Israel? Colossians chapter 1, verse 14. Yes, but that is not how the Jews thought of the word. When the disciples on the road to Emmaus said, "We trusted that it had been he which should have redeemed Israel," they thought that Christ was going to deliver them from Rome. In the scriptures, however, redemption is a purchase from the penalty of sin. So at the second advent, the Lord not only delivers the remnant of Israel from the hand of the Antichrist, he also cleanses their national sins. When that happens, he establishes a new covenant with them. Right now, that new covenant is applied spiritually to anyone who trusts the shed blood of Jesus Christ, Hebrews chapter 9, verses 14 to 15. But when the Lord originally promised that new covenant, he promised it to the house of Israel and to the house of Judah, Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 31. It has nothing to do with the Gentiles, spiritual Jews, the true Israel, or the church. It has to do with Israel being a nation before me, the Lord, forever, Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 36. The application of the new covenant to Israel is different than the spiritual application of the new covenant today. Look at Jeremiah chapter 31, verses 33 to 34. But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. After those days, saith the Lord, I will put my law in their inward parts, and write it in their hearts, and will be their God, and they shall be my people. For I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more. That is not your salvation at all. When you get saved, the law is not written in your heart. Jesus Christ, through the Holy Spirit, comes to live in your body, Romans chapter 8, and 1 Corinthians chapter 6, and 2 Corinthians chapter 6. When you get saved, you receive complete forgiveness and cleansing of sins right then and later at the rapture. Sin is removed from your body. Israel's national sins aren't blotted out until Jesus Christ returns. Acts chapter 3, verses 19 to 21. That is verse 27 of Romans chapter 11. For this is my covenant unto them, when, verse 26, I shall take away their sins. Moreover, you are to witness about what Jesus Christ has done for you. Acts chapter 1, verse 8, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. But when Israel's sins are taken away, no one is to preach or teach about Jesus Christ, Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 34, under penalty of death, Zechariah chapter 13, verse 3, because the Lord will be right there on earth with about a billion exact replicas of him walking around. Right now, God deals with individual Jews about salvation. At the Advent, Christ deals with the remnant of the Jews as a nation. In the millennium, the Lord will again deal with individual Jews concerning how they keep the law written in their hearts, Matthew chapter 5 to 7, as well as Israel corporately in the sacrifices made at the temple of Ezekiel, chapters 40 to 48. Let it be so as it's written. Amen.